And from the top of West Mountain in Scranton, Pennsylvania, good morning, everybody. This is 94.3 FM, the talk of Sanity Check. Libertarian Lou, Tea Party Mike, we got X on the line. And if you want to start this weekend off right, this cold weekend coming up, that number is 888-577-4487, 888-577-4487. Good morning, Michael.
Hey, good morning there. You know, it's Lou, it's really interesting. We talked so many times about media bias, and every now and then I just kind of encourage people to take a look, and I'll type in Fox News on the computer and headline, Hillary's emails. And then I'll go over to CNN, gun control, stop the NRA. It's absolutely amazing, Lou, to see the agendas of these two huge news networks and where they're going and what they're trying to attempt. And it's like, wouldn't you just like to wake up in the morning and just get the news and the facts?
Well, you know, once again, you know, and that's exactly what we're going to talk about today, Michael. But really what I want to do also is there might be some changes moving ahead here, and I talked to you a little bit about that. You know, some of the there might be some program changes. And what I want to do really is maybe look back and all the things that we have talked about over the years and why we've talked about certain things. And we do have X on the line, and I'm going to bring X into this conversation. The League of Women Voters, again, because this goes right to the core of what is going on. The League of Women Voters is withdrawing its sponsorship of the Presidential Debate Commission in mid-October because, and this was from 1988, and by the way, folks, they still stand by this today. But there's two sentences here that really stand out. Because of the demands of the two campaign organizations would perpetrate a fraud on the American voter. And then the second thing is, it has become clear to us that the candidates' organizations aim to add debates to their list of campaign trail charades devoid of substance, spontaneity, and honest answers. Once again, this is the League of Women Voters talking, not Lou Jasikoff talking. The League has no intention of becoming an accessory to the hoodwinking of the American public. I woke up this morning, guys, and X, we have you on the line, too, and this is one of the things that we're certainly going to talk about. But at the end of the day, when we're done with this show, I want folks to really think about, really, about what was just said here, the hoodwinking of the American public. We just had Gary Johnson on here last week or the week before and talking about the lawsuit that he filed. And one of the most important aspects of that conversation, I thought, was the discovery process. The discovery process of what this lawsuit is going to bring. And the paperwork that says the media, the Republican Party, and the Democratic Party are working together to hoodwink the American public. Folks, it's time to start waking up. It really is. And what these parties and what this corrupt media has done to this country. You know, I this morning listened to Jesse Ventura, who was on Comedy Central last night. I think it was last night, or at least I saw the YouTube for the first time this morning. And he was talking about if Hillary and Bush get the nomination, He's gonna look for the Libertarian Party and run. Oh, perhaps if he gets it, maybe Gary Johnson gets it. I think just the way the electorate is at this point in time, that it's going to be a hot property of trying to get the Libertarian nomination. But what he said was, he said, first of all, over 60% of the people did not vote in last year's presidential election, presidential election. Basically, same thing that Bernie Sanders has been saying. You know, you just don't have people engaged. So he said something about, one of the individuals asked him, well, you're going to seek the Libertarian nomination? He said, yeah. He said, but I'm going to ask him that I don't have to join the party. And they said, well, who would do that? He said, who would allow you to run under their banner and not join their party? He said, the Libertarians. he said they're for liberty. He says, I want to be the first president that does not belong to a political party. But think about that, guys. You know, think about if we had something like that. You know, and over the years, Michael, we've talked about so many different things. And I just want to touch stuff, and I'm just going to throw a few things out, and then I'm going to get everybody into this conversation. You know, we talked about the legal arm and what's going on, you know, the disciplinary arm of our government, our legal system. It's a cesspool. It is an absolute cesspool, and we've showed that. We've had Bruce Levine that brought us the custody for cash here. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. We're going to take a little bit of a segment and talk about that. How many times have you ever heard any kind of not only a politician, but even our media people asking our politician, who owns the Federal Reserve? I mean, what is wrong with asking these questions? We don't even know. Why is it? Why is that somehow so, you know, you can't, if somebody comes on air and they ask that question? Why can't we know who owns the Federal Reserve? Poor Andrew Jackson on the $20 bill, the last one that got rid of the central bank. He's twisting in his grave. Please take me off the damn $20 bill, he's saying to himself. We've talked about jury nullification. Michael, how about, you know, the whole immigration thing? Remember going all the way back there? We talked about it. We used to joke about that. Now everybody's talking about building the Great Wall of Trump. Lou Barletta. Let's build a wall. Let's make sure we build a wall. Is that what we really need? Has anybody been down to the Rio Grande? Mike, you've been to Rio Grande. It's no bigger than the Tunkhannock Creek in many spots. Are you kidding me? How about Ely, Minnesota? Anybody been up there to Boundary Waters? I've canoed the Boundary Waters. You go back, you don't see anybody for a week. You go from Canada, you go back to the United States, you go back to Canada, you go back to the United States. Is that really what we need to do? Is just build the Great Wall of Trump? Mike, do you remember we joked about this when we first came on? Remember I suggested, how about we dig a ditch? If everybody wants to build a wall, how about we just dig a ditch? A big ditch from Texas to California. We turn it into a big canal. How about we open up the prisons? We have more people in prison in this country than anywhere else in the world, probably combined in the world. You want to talk about compassion? How about we let them out, and if they work down there for 5 years digging a ditch, before we know it, in 20 years, you'd have a great canal down there. Can you imagine the economic impact if you could start shipping from California to Texas? You know, we were joking about that, but you know what? You start thinking about it. Building a wall. And compassion. How about Hillary and Bernie's compassion? It's okay for people that are going to work today. People that are driving truck. I know people are listening. They're heading to Walmart. They're going to Home Depot. Is it okay to take money, steal money from one group and give it to another? Yeah, taxes theft. How about that? It's okay to take their money and then give it to somebody else to have an abortion. And when you complain about it, the media, this corrupt media, turns around and tells you it's a war on women. And before the pro-lifers get on their high horse, how about, you know, we joked about this too, Michael. You know, life begins at conception and ends in Iraq. It's okay to send an unarmed drone over there and kill a 2-year-old baby and say, oh, we're protecting the United States. And then we hear people from Syria coming on here, from Father Anthony and all the other things that we pointed out. I mean, it's about time, guys, that we have to start waking up. And I'm going to say this again and again and again, perpetrating a fraud on the American public. And it's about being an American, for goodness sakes. Perpetrating a fraud on the American public, hoodwinking the American public. And it's being done in conjunction with the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, for the most part, and the media. Good morning, X.
Hey, guys. You know, it's interesting you're talking about, fraud on the American public. It was interesting. Almost every online poll that was done basically announced that Bernie Sanders was the big winner in the debate, especially amongst those that are active within the Democratic Party. The irony, though, was the spinmeisters are out there trying to talk about how Hillary was the winner. So I guess, it's always the establishment is painting things because they've got their, let's say, 24/7 spinmeisters out there always painting the picture as to what you're supposed to think. You know, back in the old days, the press secretary of the president would be a person that you're supposed to say, well, this is what the president's doing. Now it's, how do I cover for the president? How do I make something bad and pretend that it's not so bad. You know, you can never get candor from anybody who's an elected official because, again, the number one thing above all else, Republican, Democrat, it's always maintain the legitimacy of the existing way of doing things and the system itself. Well, what we're saying, and this is what we've been saying for years now, is the fact that the system itself, the very foundation on which things have been built, the perceptions, have serious, serious defects that need to be addressed. And the only way we can really do this is by exposing the public to hyper-transparency and having a firm and unrelenting commitment to the truth, no matter how unpleasant it may be.
Absolutely. A free and independent press and free and equal elections, Michael.
Well, you know, and all this comes into the facts of these two parties, Lou. Doing the attempt, and I think our president is probably the best at this, is doing the attempt of constantly trying to divide us, Lou. Divide us, whether it's through race, whether it's through income, whether it's through religion. And I believe it's a real attempt to make sure we stay divided. So we fight amongst ourselves as they go and work their little, weave their little webs of getting what they want at the end. It's complete power, and it's frightening to me. I think it's frightening to others who are paying attention. And we really need to hold not just the press accountable, our parties accountable. As a matter of fact, as you said, Lou, who needs the parties?
Yeah,
perhaps Jesse Ventura was right. I don't know that George Washington had a party. He just got voted in because he had probably established himself as being a fantastic leader. And we don't see that today. We don't see it today. Now, and you look at the Republican Party and the nonsense within that party, the nonsense within the Democratic Party, where the Democrats only have an option to pick who's going to run for president. That's been 6 years ago. That's Hillary Clinton.
So much is involved around these parties. Whether it's the gerrymandering of elections, we see it. Keeping people off the ballot for the party. You got to do it for the party. What would happen? Hey, let's take a call. We got Gary, and I bet we touched a nerve with Gary this morning. Good morning, Gary.
Lou, I love your rant. Keep it up. Last night I was looking on something that nobody's talking about. Once again, that's going to be rammed down our throat is this Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Oh, there deal. You go. There's another one. Right.
And I was looking last night and I was on the internet reading a bunch of things about the 20th year anniversary last year of NAFTA, a trade deal that I lost my job. A bunch of my friends lost their jobs. Some committed suicide. There were divorces, kids out of school. They lost their homes. Great trade deal. And some of the facts, 1 million U.S. jobs lost. Before NAFTA, we actually had a trade surplus with Mexico of $2.5 billion, a trade deficit with Canada of $29 billion. 20 years later, we have a $181 billion trade deficit, a doubling of immigration from Mexico, 40% higher than with countries that we don't have a trade agreement with. U.S. manufacturing and service exports have grown less than half the rate that we had before NAFTA with Mexico and Canada. And, I mean, everything, it's just a terrible, terrible trade deal. And everybody's talking about climate change. Nobody talks about anything in reality. How about our economy change in this country over the last 20, 25, 30 years. No jobs, stagnant wages, no manufacturing, no industry in this country. Shipping everything out under the rules of climate change. Well, we all live in the same earth and the same atmosphere. So if climate change is real, we're making it worse by shipping it to third world countries that don't have the standards we have.
You know,
we are bringing this country down. The next generation is going to suffer. Our children, our grandchildren are going to suffer because of the thievery and treason going on in Washington, D.C. And I ask everybody that's listening, do you think Tom Marino, Lou Barletta, Obama's children, Hillary Clinton's children have to worry about the future like our kids do? No, because everything is going to be on a golden platter for their parents selling out this country. Thank you for your time.
Well, there you go, guys. Now, so listen, just talking about whole climate change and everything else, we've said before, Michael, and once again, I'm going to, this is going to be tongue-in-cheek a little bit, but I'm going to say that the libertarians are leading the way again. We're saying, you know what? We want the planet to warm up. How about that? How about that, X? We want people to eat more. We want more meat-based diet because that adds more carbon dioxide into the air than anything else. You pointed that out. We want to drill, baby, drill. You know why? Because you know what? When Yellowstone blows and there's a nuclear winter, the libertarians are going to understand that if the Earth was warmed up, that'll keep us from having another ice age. Let's take a break. When we come back, we got more people on the line. You listen to Sanity Check on 94.3 FM, The Talker.
94.3 FM, The Talker.
I know nothing, I see nothing, and I say nothing. I know nothing, I see nothing, and I say nothing.
Hey, Michael, you remember that? The know-nothing solicitor, when we were going into the courts, we were getting thrown out. They're lying to us in the courts. I mean, it's just unbelievable. And the reason we played that, and we're going to play a couple of the other clips that we've done over the years here. But right now, one of the individuals that actually brought this story to us, the whole story of custody for cash. We had Kids for Cash here in Northeast Pennsylvania. We had precedent. We had precedent to understand that, you know, what was happening in the courts, they weren't protecting the children. That's precedent. And then when we found out, excuse me, about what was happening and individuals like a Bruce Levine and there's so many a host of others that came forward after that, we were so swamped from people around the country calling in about what was happening in the courts and children being taken. We're going to play the Nancy Schaefer clip. But right now I have Bruce on the line. Good morning, Bruce.
Good morning, Lou and everyone. How are you doing?
Great, you know, and what we're talking about here a little bit today is we're kind of reminiscing a little bit about what has happened and what we've talked about over the years, and certainly you were the one, and I've said things, you know, like once things are in the books, they can't take it back, and you were the one that brought the whole custody for cash to us originally, and I got to tell you, you opened up my eyes to what is happening in this corrupt, absolutely corrupt court system that, once again, the media, the Republicans, the Democrats, our politicians just refuse to actually look at. Why can't we have hearings? Why is it that individuals like yourself and a host of all kinds of folks that have come forward, why can't we have open hearings?
You know, Lou, I got to thank you. You know, you shed light for the people in the community in Luzerne, Lackawanna County in Northeast Pennsylvania. You really start to shed light on the subject. Other media outlets, including, of course, government agencies were unwilling to take a look at this. They were unwilling to talk about it. Attorneys that I went to, as you know, but to refresh, said they couldn't help because they would be blackballed. They knew what was going on. The government agencies, Lackawanna County District Attorney, the FBI, the Department of Justice, Pennsylvania Attorney General, said, well, it's not our jurisdiction.
Yeah.
What you're talking about is only conjecture. You know, and I brought them the facts. And they knew what was going on, and nobody was able to help. And I think of, nobody wanted to help, and I think of if it were their children, then, as was pointed out before, there would be that sort of their Teflon. They're really not. But if it was their children, really, that were stolen, that were taken away from them, hearts being tugged, you know, that heart-wrenching loss of your child being taken from you for no reason.
Or if you want to visit your child, on Thanksgiving, pay cash. Cash, baby, cash. Forget about drill, baby, drill. More cash.
Correct. So you had this, you know, this battle trying to convey that, hey, something has to be done. You know, in my case, it's been 7 years since I was first brought into the system. But the goal was to shed some light and to let other people know, for me, after my ordeal and my family's ordeal, to let people know they weren't alone. And let's do something and foster change. Let them know that there is hope, that there is healing, that there are people that want to help. And you've been on the forefront of this. And you and our colleagues have helped people in Luzerne County and Northeast Pennsylvania, been to court with them and gone to to politicians and said, let's do something. And we're not letting down. We're not giving up.
No, we're not. We're not letting down. And in fact, Bruce, because of your efforts and the efforts of others, whether it's Judy Laura, I mean, I could go on. I don't want to necessarily. I did this the other day, and you know, I start naming names, and then you forget names, and then I feel terrible after I start thinking, oh, I didn't say this one, I didn't say that one, and there's so many great individuals out there that have done so much. But this past week, I got a call from an elected official and said, Lou, please, it's time. Time to come and talk. Get before council. We will get you the time to get to talk to council. They are now starting to do an investigation in Luzerne County on children and youth because the unfortunate event that happened with that young boy dying, and all of a sudden now Tara Tuhill is coming forward and they're going to do an investigation. One thing, Bruce, that we have to remember and one thing that we have to do is make sure these reports are not whitewashed like the AOPC report. Remember the AOPC report? That something that you were on the forefront when they were talking about the Danielle Ross and all this other stuff, and that they praised her, and now she just got out of jail, and I think you're on the top of that too, saying, wait a minute, how can this woman who has tortured so many people now is going to do what here in this county?
Yeah, so apparently teaching others how to become a guardian ad litem.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, to get cash.
Go figure.
But one of the things, Bruce, is and we need to get this out too. This week, Tuesday, we are getting together. We're going to meet out towards Twiggs. I think on Tuesday, a number of individuals that were involved with the whole custody for cash issues and stuff. What's happening with them is that we're going to meet and we're going to start putting together a program so that we can. Present this. So if people have been abused by the court, reach out to Bruce. I mean, there's ways to get to them. They know how to get to us. It's very, very important that we stay on top of this, Bruce, and make sure that these individuals can come forward.
Well, you're right. And you know, you talked about the investigation or the hearings that are going to be held with counsel in Luzerne County. This needs to be done in the people in Lackawanna County as well, and this is what's going to happen. But it wouldn't have happened. It takes effort. It takes coordinated effort. It takes people that care, that have a heart. I've been out of the system. My ordeal is over.
Right.
It happened, but I was committed because of the pain and the suffering and the hurt and the damage to my family. And then when I saw that it was happening to others, I was committed to helping others. So naturally, you become an inspiration. You become a light unto others. And helping is healing. And those that we know, you know them, that are going through very difficult times, continue to help others because it helps them move forward. This is, as I said before, often, especially with the children, a life or death situation. This is a very serious matter. Very serious. And we have the facts, Lou, and the government knows. And other talk shows, they're immune. The little folk like you and I and everyone else that you know, we're not immune. They know, and they don't do anything. So I'm glad, and I'm proud to say I know you as a friend and Sanity Check crew, and that we are moving forward and helping others. Wonderful.
Bruce, thanks for that. Let's make sure that not only our groups and people that are involved with us know that that we have been reached out to now. There is an investigation, somewhat of an investigation going on in Luzerne County. Even if your case is not involved with Luzerne County, it's important that your voice is heard. Obviously, we're going to focus on exactly what's happening in Luzerne because that's where they're looking for the investigation to go on. But because of the efforts that have went on for a very long period of time, we certainly have raised awareness. I think just one child, unfortunately, when I say one child dying in children and youth, I don't think maybe it would have garnered the, not necessarily the support, but the awareness that all of a sudden they want to have investigations if we haven't been talking about this. And even David Madeira and the people on this station has raised awareness in ways that it wasn't happening prior, Bruce.
Correct. And Andy Ostrowski has been helpful as well, extremely helpful in getting down there to Scranton and meeting with people. And, again, a group of people, not just Andy alone.
That's right.
Arm in arm, together, right. That's the that's really cool to see that support, coordinated togetherness.
And there's all kinds of people, and that's and once again, like, for all those that have suffered, for all those that have brought information to us, for all those that we haven't even been able to follow up on, we apologize for that. But thank you for coming forward, because we know how difficult that is, Bruce. I'm going to play a clip by Nancy Schaefer, and then we're going to head into break. Thank you for coming on today, and we'll be talking again shortly.
Thank you, Lou. Have a wonderful day, guys.
However, my report is concerned with the children and parents caught up in legal kidnapping. Having worked with probably 300 cases statewide and hundreds across the country, and in nearly every state, I am convinced there is no accountability in Child Protective Services. I have come to several conclusions. Two or three are, one, that poor parents, not always, but oftentimes, are targeted to lose their children because they do not have the wherewithal to hire an attorney and fight the system. That caseworkers and social workers are very often guilty of fraud. They withhold and destroy evidence. They fabricate evidence, and they seek to terminate parental rights unnecessarily. That the separation of families and the snatching of children is growing as the business grows because state and local governments have grown accustomed to having these taxpayer dollars to balance their ever-growing budgets. That the bureaucracy is huge. Look at who is getting paid. State employees, attorneys, court investigators, guardian ad litems, court personnel and judges. There are psychologists, therapists, psychiatrists, counselors, foster parents, adoptive parents, and on, all are looking to the children in state custody to provide job security. That the Adoption and the Safe Families Act, set in motion first in 1974 by Walter Mondale and later in 1997 by President Bill Clinton, offered cash bonuses to the states for every child they adopted out of foster care. In order to receive the adoption incentive bonuses, local Child Protective Services would need more children. They must have merchandise that sells, and they must have plenty so the buyer can choose. Here are a couple of the recommendations on my list. Call for an independent audit of all state Child Protective Services and for a federal congressional hearing on Child Protective Services. Abolish the federal and state financial incentives that have turned Child Protective Services into a business that separates families for money. I have witnessed such injustice and harm brought to so many families that I am not sure if reform of the system is even possible. The system cannot be trusted. It does not serve the people. It obliterates families and children simply because it has the power to do so. What I have said to you in these few minutes is that we must confront the fraud in Child Protective Services. Child Protective Services seizes children using the very system that is paid for by the taxpayer, who actually believes it is used to protect abused and neglected children. The bureaucracy of workers benefit financially by a system that converts children into cash while destroying their families and their lives. No child who emerges from the system can ever be sound or whole. Many disappear and never are ever heard from again. God will not stand for what is happening to our children and our families. His heart beats for these children. He will lift up the downtrodden. What is happening in America regarding Child Protective Services is a criminal political phenomenon, and it must be brought to an end. Please join me in working to help set our children and our families free, to whom much is given, much is required. As you pray for this nation, pray for the upcoming election and for our national financial crisis. Please pray for our children and for our families. We all must press on and win this race for America. Thank you very much.
We'll be right back.
The answer you're looking for lies right here.
94.3 FM, The Talker.
This came, by the way, from a caller to my radio show, Jason from Washington, D.C. He's an insider. He's connected inside Washington, and that's the secret buzz going on inside the Beltway.
So listen to a word I say.
Jason. The screams all sound the same. From Washington, D.C. Jason. Jason. He's an insider. He's connected inside Washington.
And we're back, 94.3 FM, the talk of Sanity Check, Libertarian Lou and Tea Party Mike, and we have X on the line. Three things, guys, from this song that we should know and just from our last segment. First thing, there's no reason to have cameras in the courtroom. There's no reason to have audio in the courtroom because we have precedent that our children are protected when they go into this courtroom. Not kids for cash, guys. Don't believe a word we say. That's right there in that song. And we continue to say that. If you get nothing else out of what we've done all these years, Michael, don't believe a word we say. Do your own research. It is important that you actually look and really dissect what you're being told. And part of that also is just what we talked about here. Jason, X, the insider. X, do you remember that, man, when that happened? I'm watching Fox News, and all of a sudden I'm watching this guy on there talking about X, Jason, the insider. I'm thinking, Jason, the insider, talking about stuff. All of a sudden, you became this insider go-to guy because you called a radio station. Then I'm watching Huffington Post saying the same thing, and I'm saying, holy cow, this is crazy. You talk about media and media just regurgitating what's going on. I mean, we could talk about the AP poll. We're going to play a little bit of Operation Mockingbird. But X, just remind folks what happened when you're there in Spago's and all this other stuff and how this media is so corrupted. And that's how, and this is how everybody's getting their news.
Well, I mean, again, the closeness between the press and our elected officials is almost incestuous. The problem that we have, again, is the fact that you have a revolving door where people that are in politics are going back and forth between the media and these consulting jobs, and it just goes around and around and around. So, you know, I'm in Cafe Milano, which is the spot, let's call it the Spago of Washington, D.C. That's the, the spot to be seen in Georgetown. And I'm sitting there, and there's Jay Carney, the present press secretary of the time, sitting with George Stephanopoulos, who was the former press secretary under Bill Clinton, who now masquerades as a journalist. And he's sitting there with Michael J. Fox, who played the press secretary on television. So you're sitting here, and you know, you can't write a script that's more crazy than what we're dealing with, because again, it's designed for you. You're somehow thinking like the press are really going after. The press doesn't go after anyone because they will lose access to the political people so that they can write their story. So if you come out and you start pressing President, let's say Obama right now, on the fact that how is it that the Russians seem to be wiping up ISIS here, and we've been bombing them for years now, and with basically no results or very small results. How is it that the Russians could be more effective in the last, 60 days than we have been in the last, 60 months?
Yeah.
And you have, and this is what will happen. Well, if you're the reporter that asked that question, then you basically don't get any more interviews. And then, of course, your career goes in the toilet because, of course, if you can't get the interviews, then what good are you? We'll get more people in. So it goes around and around. And this is, I think this is the whole rise of alternative media. This is why Sanity Check exists. This is why alternative websites, newspapers like the Independent Gazette, because if we don't get this information out, it's not going to happen through the normal channels. I mean, what major news organization is covering the fact about these drugs? You know, when Glaxo got fined $3 billion, which was the largest pharmaceutical fine in history, because they were using drugs like Paxil on minors, which obviously you don't want to give anything to anybody under the age of 18 because your brain is still being formed. How is it that a company can be worthy of a $3 billion fine, but not a single person goes to jail? You notice how during the debates that were going on, they all seem to be talking as if their party has not been in the office, the Oval Office.
Yeah.
Who was the Attorney General that allowed HSBC, which was guilty, 100% admitted, there's nothing ambiguous about this, they were laundering illegal drug cartel money to the tune of billions of dollars. But the Attorney General could not put a single person in jail, let alone give them a timeout in the corner. So, but God forbid your poor kid gets caught with a joint, and they, what are they going to do? Well, they pull your son over. He's got a joint in the car. They confiscate your car. Your kid ends up in detention facilities. I mean, but you can launder the drug money to the tune of billions of dollars, and that's just a cost of doing business. Pay a fine. Keep moving on.
You know,
I'd like to rob a bank too. And if I get caught, I just pay a fine, but I still get to go home with the money.
Michael, there you go. I don't even know where to go with that. But, you know, X brought this thing up about losing access. And we've been saying that what we are doing with the Independent Gazette, with the radio show, with the whole Freedom Ring project, which I encourage people to at least go and look at. It's at quadindependentgazette.com. That's Quad Independent Gazette. Just go there or go to our Facebook. Just look at that because it is so impossible. It really
now, Lou,
is. Go ahead.
Lou, point out the fact that you've had people at the other major media sources come to you and say, please break this story. That way we can cover it because we can't cover it first.
Yeah,
we'll have it.
Explain that to the
audience.
Yeah, that you're exactly right. Think about that, Michael, right? I mean, we know that, and we're saying to everybody, listen, we know what we're doing. X, you just brought this up. Michael, you lose access.
Okay.
We're just doing it. I don't know how we're doing it. You know, people here say, well, how are we going to do this? But you have to do this because if you don't have a free and independent press, I don't know how you get this information out. And it's human nature. When you write something that is not complimentary, like you just brought up, X, whether you do it about Obama, I don't care who you do it, about Senator Baker, about Barletta, about any of our politicians, Cartwright. Hey, they, you know what? They don't want that you lose access. One of the reasons I still give credit for Marino coming on here only because whether we agree, disagree, whatever else, if we don't have a conversation, I don't know how we move forward, Michael.
Well, you know, Lou, you talk about the media, and if you remember the opportunity I had to go down and see Catherine Sebelius from the HHS here in San Antonio. And
yeah.
Lou, it amazed me how staged the entire event was. I mean, there was absolutely not going to be a tough question in that entire 2 hours that we were there. That questions were only allowed to be given by those that were picked prior to, you know, coming into the room. That Catherine Sebelius knew right away who to, you know, pick for the questions and not pick for the questions. And it's a big fraud, Lou. It's a huge fraud.
Yeah, Michael, you're so right, because what happens is many of these press events nowadays, even these rallies that you see for political candidates, are all staged. I mean, I've been on these things where you have these phone calls, you know, for your congressman, and you're supposed to be listening in, and you can push one to ask your congressman a question. But it seems like all the people at the head of the line that get to ask all the questions, they seem to be the type of questions that your press secretary would write for the candidate. You know, you never get anybody that the questions are hard-hitting from the audience. There, and of course, you know, what do? You stack the deck. You know, there was this thing the other day, they were talking about how at one of the Trump rallies, there's a possibility that one of the people worked for the Bush campaign. You know, again, it's numerous. How about how many times we pointed out, Lou, right, when there's a political rally, the person goes down there and takes a picture, there might be 10 people there, but from the angle, it looks like it's really crowded, or it's a really crowded event, and what they do is they take a picture from a certain angle, so it looks like nobody's there.
Oh, yeah. I remember Ron Paul events or something. There'd be 10,000 people there, you know, and all of a sudden, you know, of course, they were correct. Over 200 people there. I know maybe we're exaggerating, but, I mean, this is exactly what the game was, and we pointed that out on another thing. Listen, one of the things I do want to play in another clip, I want to remind folks, this is not theory. I mean, this is fact. I mean, let's just listen to a little piece, guys, and we'll go into break with this from the Church Commission. in 1970s, where the CIA is planting, where they're saying that the media has been bought off. Nothing has changed. It's even gotten worse. Let's listen to this. We'll take a break for, and we'll come back to our last segment. We'll listen to 94.3 FM, The Talker, Sanity Check.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to a major circulation American journal?
We do have people who submit pieces to other two American journals.
Do you have any people paid by the CIA who are working for television networks?
This, I think, gets into the kind of getting into the details, Mr. Chairman, that I'd like to get into in executive session.
At CBS, we had been contacted by the CIA. As a matter of fact, by the time I became the head of the whole news and public affairs operation in 1954, the ships had been established, and I was told about them and asked if I'd carry on with them. Not that it was a matter of real concern that planted stories intended to serve a national purpose abroad came home and were circulated here and believed here, because this would mean that the CIA could manipulate the news in the United States by channeling it through some foreign country. Now, we're looking at that very carefully. We have quite a lot of detailed information.
Tea Party Mike, Libertarian Lou. Their Sanity Check. Saturday mornings, 94.3 FM. Yeah. Saturday mornings, 94.3 FM, The Talker.
You can be amazing, you can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast or be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way the words do when they settle near your skin. Kept on the inside and no sunlight, sometimes a shadow wins. But I wonder what would happen if you say what you want to say.
For all our listeners, thank you for being brave and speaking out. So many people that have been mistreated and abused by our court system. Michael, one of the things I definitely want to touch on before we just get into the last few minutes of this is we certainly also talked about jury nullification. Our third president, Thomas Jefferson, put it like this: I consider trial by jury as the only anchor yet imagined by man which government can be held to the principles of its constitution. And John Adams, our second president, had this to say about the juror: it is not only his right but his duty to find the verdict according to his own best understanding, judgment, and conscience, though it is in direct opposition to the direction of the court. We have an obligation, folks. I listened to the debates, the Democratic debates, and Snowden is a criminal. Let me remind you that Rosa Parks was also a criminal. People need to stand up when they see abuse going on in this government. And what's happening in our own backyards, and it's tough to be brave, it's tough to stand up, but you have to speak out, otherwise we get what we're getting. And everywhere we look, it's corruption, nepotism, cronyism. Our communities are being torn apart because people don't speak out, that we believe what we're hearing on the news. And we urge folks. And one of the reasons, Michael, and I want to just bring this up now too a little bit, is that there might be some programming changes here. I'm going to meet with the folks here from Bold Gold on Monday, and there just might be some changes. So it's possible this was our last show, and we just wanted to let folks know, if we are not here next week, that, you know, there is a reason. And I can't say enough for Vince and for Brian Spinelli and giving us an opportunity, regardless of how it turns out next week, Michael, because you know what? 4 years ago, 4 years ago, Tea Party Mike Lacey probably could have gotten a show, but very few people, very few radio stations would have allowed Libertarian Lou to be on this radio station. And that's a fact. And X, you know that, and how many times are you still, to this day, not allowed to come on a show because you say that you have a libertarian view? So, Michael, go ahead, guys.
I'll just throw this out here. Lou, I have been on so many radio shows across the entire country, and the program managers, I have encountered this multiple times. If I'm a caller and I try to espouse views that sometimes are, and I make it clear, you know, hey, I'm a libertarian, this is my view. I've had program managers say things like, well, you can come on, but don't say anything about libertarian. You criticize the president, we're okay with that, but don't say you're a libertarian. They don't want the public to understand that there's other options out there. And that's again, the funneling of this information. Remember, during the presidential debate, that went on the other day, remember Hillary Clinton made it seem like Edward Snowden ran to Russia. No, actually, he didn't. What happened was Edward Snowden, when he was in the airport on his way out to South America, he was originally going to probably end up down in Brazil. The State Department revoked his passport when he was in Russia. So the reason Edward Snowden is in Russia is because the State Department, which Hillary Clinton was there, pulled his thing. But they're trying to trick everybody. So just the other day, there's a blatant lie that's going on, or a fraud perpetrator across the American public. And this is why it's so important what we're doing.
It absolutely is. And Michael, I know, you know, certainly we're into our fourth year here, and we've covered so many different topics. But I know people are trying to call. Let's take Ben real quick. Ben, good morning.
Lou, apologize for being so late calling in, buddy, but I actually had some work to do this morning.
There you go.
You and I talked last week off the air, and we talked about the taxes and the way that Sid Kervulik and Eddie DePaschinski voted to raise our taxes 16% without any problem whatsoever, even though it didn't go through right away, and it still may. We don't know how that'll wind up. People need to start looking at this, but I was wondering if you even mentioned the fact that the Luzerne County manager, in his proposal for the budget for next year, has another 8% increase in county taxes proposed there. If that goes through, my county taxes have gone up 70% in the last 10 years.
Yeah, and Ben, obviously we're down to the last few minutes, and it's absolutely criminal what's going on. And once again, it always comes across somehow it's compassion that they're taking care of other people. How about the people that are going to work today? Where's the compassion on them? 70.
Yep.
You know, Frank Sorek is in here every week. I work with another woman. Foreclosures are out of control.
Yeah,
seniors are getting taxed out of their house.
You could have seen her face that day.
Yeah, where's the compassion on all this stuff?
It was absolutely heartbreaking. Heartbreaking when she had to move out of that home that she worked her whole life to have because my father-in-law passed away and she lost that Social Security.
Ben, thanks for...
It's just hard. It's hard to understand.
Ben, thanks for staying with us here. And
thanks for being there, guys.
You betcha, man. Hey, Michael, you know, once again, you warned people of that. That's one of the reasons why you moved out of a place that you were born and raised in, and you moved to Texas. And you warned Luzerne County Council this 2 years ago. People like yourself are going to start packing up and leaving. We just it just cannot continue to happen.
Lou, it can. You know, even the seniors who are packing up and leaving the nation because of this, choosing, there's over 600,000 retirees have moved out of the country because of it. So this is where we're going. This is not the nation that was promised to us by our founders. You know, and I really applaud our listeners who have been able to take some of our information and really have an open mind of what we're trying to say and what we're trying to get out there. And, you know, my hat's off to our listeners, Lou. They've been absolutely wonderful over the last 4 years.
Certainly has. And once again, Michael, like I brought up, you know, I don't know where it's all going, but there might just be program. It's the way business is. I mean, sometimes, you know, you just move forward and you do different things. But once again, I really can't say enough, no matter how things go. And we might be here Saturday. I have no idea, and we might not be. But I did want to just throw that out there. And I cannot say enough, and I will continue to say it next week, next month, next year. that 94.3 FM, The Talker, allowed somebody like Libertarian Lou had to have the opportunity to talk, because we have said all along there were so many other things I wanted to get into today, guys, and regardless of what happens here, you know, I wanted to talk about gun control. People wrote us information on that, but we have to have these conversations, Michael, and we need to continue to have these conversations and allow people, because once we do have these conversations, we see that, you know, people's minds change. Because I'll say it over and over, we all want the same things in life. We want clean air. We want clean water. We want safe and secure roof over our heads for our kids and our grandkids. We want quality education. We want affordable health care. This is universal, Michael. And all I could say is thank you. Thank you for this station. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to move, at the very least, get people to know who we are, Michael. We're down to the last 40 seconds, Michael. Your last words and sign off. As you always do, my friend.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, you're right, Lou. Thank you for all the blessings that we've had over the last 4 years, and God bless all as usual.
God bless everybody, and have a great weekend, and you'll be hearing from us one way or the other. Sanity Check on 94.3 FM, The Talker.